to remind you to please turn on your T-coil and silence your cell phones. I have just one announcement this morning before we get to our lecture, and that is that next week begins George Drake's four-class course on Joe Rosenfield. As you know, Joe Rosenfield is a much admired and revered alumnus of Grinnell College. Well, George is too, but he's going to be talking about Joe. If you have a bucket course, a folder like this, please bring it next time, because George will have a handout or two, and this will help you keep track of it. If you don't have one of these folders, we will have some extras for you, so you'll be able to pick one up here. Mike Latham is the Dean of Grinnell College, Vice President of Academic Affairs, and that would ordinarily be enough for one person, but in addition to that, he's a professor of history, and that's the part that we're going to enjoy this morning. How many of you here are veterans of World War II? I knew we had one. What would we do without our family? How many of you are veterans of the home front of World War II? Yeah, that's a few more of us, isn't it? Well, I'll bet you that Mike is going to be able to tell you things about the World War II home front that you never knew before. And I'm delighted to welcome our first timer for the bucket courses, Professor Mike Latham.
So thank you, Joanne. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
I'm wired for sound here. I feel like mission control. So I hope everybody's got a good transmission. I really want to thank Joanne. I want to thank Bob. I want to thank all who organized this event. It's really a pleasure to be here and to thank you all for coming. This is a subject that has been of great interest to me for a long time. My grandfather was a U.S. Navy officer in the Pacific, was in submarines. My father was also a career Navy officer, and I grew up at Pearl Harbor. So this is a subject that's been on my mind for really since I was a child, and it's something that shaped a lot of my thinking. I'm going to go ahead and talk for some time. We'll take a short break, and then I'll conclude. And I hope you'll save your questions, because I expect we'll have some time at the end of the presentation for questions, and I would really like to have a chance to respond to questions that you all have. And it's again, a pleasure to be here. Even before Pearl Harbor, even before December 7th of 1941, Franklin Delano Roosevelt had defined American purposes in the war in sweeping democratic terms. January 6th of 1941, in the famous Four Freedoms speech, he described the United States as seeking to promote freedom of speech and expression, religious freedom, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. That those were the key elements of America's role in the world. The war against fascism and dictatorship would be everywhere grounded in freedom. In Roosevelt's terms, that required the supremacy of human rights, as he put it, a global supremacy of human rights. In August of 1941, by that point, of course, the war was raging in Asia and in Europe. In August of 1941, Roosevelt met with Churchill, and they issued the Atlantic Charter, a famous declaration of Allied war aims. And here you see similar kinds of statements. The United States pledged with Great Britain to defend the right of all peoples to choose the form of government under which they will live. That joint declaration in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, the right of all peoples to choose the form of government under which they would live. The aspiration then, as stated by Roosevelt, as stated by Churchill as well, but certainly emphatically by Roosevelt, was to create a world of open political participation, liberal economic prosperity, and greater human freedom in opposition to the new order of dictatorship emerging in Nazi Germany, fascist Italy, and imperial Japan. And yet mobilization for war raised some pivotal questions for the United States. Would it be possible for a liberal democracy to make war as effectively as a centralized authoritarian state? Could you mobilize for war? Could you run the preparation for war and the war itself as effectively as your autocratic opponents? How would the demands of a war against fascism affect a democratic society? What impact would mobilization for war and carrying out of war have on American values? And finally, could a liberal democracy defeat an axis of authoritarian dictators without undermining the very democratic values and principles for which it stood? There were deep divisions on these questions. In fact, deep divisions within American public opinion prior to Pearl Harbor about whether or not the United States actually should be involved in the global war that was emerging. During the 1930s, isolationists in Congress and really in much of American public opinion had believed that the dangers of that were too great. The Neutrality Acts, which had been issued by Congress, sharply constrained Roosevelt's ability to assist the Allies as the war unfolded. And many people actually believed that the last time the United States had become involved in global war had proven a futile failure. People looked back, for example, to the ambitions of Woodrow Wilson in the First World War. And they talked about Wilson's vision to create a world that would be safe for democracy, his goal for a League of Nations, his attempt to create a structure in which war would never emerge again. And of course, in less than a generation, the great powers of Europe and Asia were at each other's throats. And so the idea that the United States would be able to uphold such values was one that many Americans viewed with a great deal of skepticism. But Roosevelt and his allies took a sharply internationalist perspective. American security, they believed, required intervention and direct engagement. And while it's a subject for much longer discussion, perhaps in another venue, to some extent what Roosevelt was already doing was thinking less about defense and more about security. The fundamental questions that Roosevelt was beginning to ask ultimately had to do with the ability of the United States to create a world environment in which its ideals and values would be most likely to spread and prosper. But the problem remained of just how to do that. And my argument today, in fact, will be that on the home front, the results were both complicated and mixed. Total victory over the Axis was achieved by a massive and stunning mobilization, and that was undeniably a tremendous success. Contrary to the fears of the isolationists, democratic values were neither destroyed nor abandoned. In fact, there was, I would argue, a significant amount of progress for many Americans. That said, however, I think it would be a mistake to romanticize World War II's home front as a golden age of perfect harmony or unequivocal gain. There were significant gains, but the strains of war also revealed the real and continuing limits to the ideal of creating a genuinely liberal American multiracial democracy. And I'd like to give you a sense of how some of those trade-offs played out over time. One of the great successes of the war, of course, had to do with mobilization for war itself. And the results here were really quite striking. Mobilization for war created immense demands for American labor. And in fact, the U.S. gross national product doubled within only 4 years. The lingering impacts of the Great Depression were still felt in the late 1930s. In 1940, unemployment still stood at 14%, remarkably high, but unemployment had virtually disappeared by 1943. The federal budget in 1940 was $9 billion. The federal budget in 1945 was $98 billion. So that was over a tenfold increase in the course of the war. And this is really a staggering moment in which the size and scope of the federal government's responsibilities dramatically increase. And really, the demand for labor effectively ended the Depression itself. Over 15 million men were trained and equipped for the war. 350,000 women served in the military as well. But the Roosevelt administration knew that they could not allow the free market to determine the cost and pace of military and civilian production. they would have to play a much larger role in directly manipulating and intervening in the economy to make this possible. At the war's peak, the military commanded a full 47% of all production and services. That's a really staggering figure if you think about it. Nearly half of American production and services were ultimately driven by the war's purposes. And the government had to find ways to keep that machine running. The requirement then was for this kind of heavy intervention, for a great deal of planning. The government created controls on the distribution and cost of virtually everything, from steel, to machine tools, to chickens, to chocolate, to clothing. Across the American economy, all of these goods were effectively regulated and their production was managed in pursuit of the war effort itself. One of the greatest successes, of course, was the reconversion of the economy to a wartime footing, something that was done really very quickly. The United States spent about $250 million per day to defeat the Axis. Federal spending during World War II totaled 10 times more that of World War I, and it was nearly double the amount that had been spent by the government since its founding in 1789. That's really kind of remarkable. More than double what they had spent previously in the entire history of the United States in that five-year period. Real wages for workers also climbed dramatically during the war. In fact, they rose by about 27% during the war, and even more rapidly for people at the bottom of the pay scale. This marked the most progressive redistribution of American wealth in the 20th century. And in fact, if you look at concentrations of wealth in the United States, what you actually see is that the degree of inequality here decreases substantially as the labor demands of the war unfold. But those effects also resulted in the further concentration of the U.S. economy. In 1940, the top 100 firms in size in the U.S. produced about 30% of U.S. manufactured goods. By 1945, the top 100 firms produced about 70% of U.S. manufactured goods. So the largest firms, with their economies of scale, with their efficiency, with their higher rates of productivity, benefited strongly from military contracting. And the federal government sought out those foreign firms and did business with them because they could deliver products so quickly and so much more cheaply. The big firms then effectively got larger. The small businesses were frequently wiped out. So what we see here is actually a pretty complex situation. In many ways, there's a substantial redistribution of wealth toward workers. Wages for workers increased significantly, and yet the concentration of firms in control, the sort of not monopolistic but oligopolistic control, begins to increase. And the scale and role of the federal government increases dramatically. In fact, Roosevelt created a whole series of agencies, the War Production Board, for example. They rationed prices, they directed the War Manpower Board. They really, in effect, reached deeply into the economy, in pricing, in labor, in the management of industry, in an attempt to create the most effective and smoothly functioning, most powerful machine that they could. The results were tremendous. Ultimately, the United States, because of its tremendous industrial capacity, was able to create this very effective war machine to fight on both sides. But as you might imagine, this, again, had mixed results. Among the people who were most alienated by this, in fact, were American conservatives, who were probably not happy about the progressive redistribution of wealth in some ways, but were even less happy about what they saw as the wiping out of small business and the greater degree of federal government intervention directly into the economy. For those who were conservatives believing that government should remain small, believing that it was wrong to have this degree of engagement, this was sort of the New Deal on steroids. This was what they did not want to see. And of course, many of them were very worried that when the war ended, this relationship itself would also not end. And they began to worry about the longer term consequences of such a vastly expanded federal government and federal control in the economy itself. Ultimately, this was a tremendous success, however. Interestingly enough, among the people who recognized the tremendous power here that the United States would bring to bear were the Japanese. among Japanese leaders, for example, there was a sense that Japan might survive a short war with the United States, but not a long one. And in many respects, the desire to strike at Pearl Harbor, the desire to try and achieve a settled peace quickly, so that the United States would direct its attention to the fighting in Europe and accept as a fait accompli what Japan was doing in China and Southeast Asia, was contingent on a short war. As the war went on longer and longer and longer, this military conversion ultimately tipped the pan strongly in the favor of the United States. The war also had tremendous impacts on the lives of women. And the labor demands for the war really transformed women's lives. The War Manpower Commission launched a special campaign to recruit women into the workforce, especially married housewives, many of whom became enlisted in the defense industry. Government propaganda declared that women had a patriotic obligation to serve and to support men at the front. And the cultural shift here is a really interesting one. Patriotic demands required women to move into the workplace, but the assumptions underlying their participation were not what I think you and I might recognize as feminist ones. Women themselves certainly made the most of the shift and interpreted it on their own terms. Many, of course, found a sense of liberation, being able to step outside the home, to develop skills or techniques they never knew that they were able to do, to find a sense of mission and purpose, to contribute to the war. If you read the oral histories of the period, they're really quite striking. They talk about women going to Sunday dinner at home, talking about which drill bit would cut metal the fastest, as opposed to, you know, what happened at church that morning. And it's really quite fascinating to see, and there really is a significant cultural shift. The number of women employed during the course of the war leapt from 11 million to about 20 million. Hundreds of thousands of women also moved from low-paying jobs into more lucrative industrial work. And the most dramatic turns here happened actually in heavy industry. In 1940, only about 5% of American auto employees were women. By 1944, about 20% were. So even in some of the most heavily unionized areas, even some of the areas where men had really been most dominantly involved on the factory floor, women made significant gains. African-American women had benefited too. Previously, they were largely restricted to agricultural, to domestic work before the war, but they too moved into higher-paying factory, clerical, and sales jobs. And yet popular understandings of women's rights, perhaps the central question you and I might ask, remain largely untransformed. Many male workers resented the presence of women alongside them on the shop floor. They saw them as a threat to their jobs, a threat to their livelihood later. The popular expectation was that when the war was over, Rosie the Riveter would return to her job. She would return home. And a returning serviceman would then move back into the factory floor. So what we saw here were really sort of gains that were partial, but not sweeping in terms of cultural terms or understandings of women's roles. Cultural propaganda also declared that when government propaganda declared that when the war was over, women would return, that their service was expedient, they were backing men at the front. Women also earned only about 65% of what men did for the same work, which is a sobering fact. So while they were on the shop floor, they were not achieving parity in terms of compensation or income, even when they were doing similar work itself. Cultural practices within families and households were also slow to change. And if you look at, again, the oral history and the cultural history of the period, you see this. Working wives and mothers, in some respects, wound up carrying the double burden of both homework and external wage work. Daycare was inadequate, it was expensive, it was limited. By 1944, in fact, many women who actually continued to serve working in factories, married women with children who served in factories, were actually beginning to be accused in letters of opinion and in newspaper articles of contributing to juvenile delinquency because they weren't doing enough, supposedly, to assist and support their children at home. So what we see here is kind of a limited and a partial shift. Women move into the workforce. They experience much greater opportunity. They find different ways in which they can build skills. They find a different kind of community. And yet, they don't receive the same amount of pay, certainly. And the cultural transformations you would look for don't move to the same degree that you and I might think or might expect. Another place where I think we see this kind of partial shift and a very complex series of questions has to do with African Americans and the war itself. And I'm going to spend some time talking about this issue because it's another sort of fascinating case in which America's ideals for the war bump up against some of America's own cultural norms and practices. From the very start of the war, there was clear awareness by FDR and by his lead advisors of the political problem that the United States faced in fighting against fascist regimes in Japan and Germany that made overt claims to racial superiority. It was hard to do that in the name of democracy when your own society at home was racially segregated. So this was one of the great ironies of the war. The fascist government in Nazi Germany, certainly the Imperial Japanese, the way that they talked about their role in Asia, made distinctive claims to racial superiority. They talked about racial destiny. They used the language which ultimately shaped and defined the fascist regime. The United States promised to challenge them by doing so in the name of democracy, in the name of liberty, and that the United States still, of course, had to try to do that while at the same time, the underlying fact, the elephant in the room, was that the United States had its own deeply segregated society, and that was a fact of daily American life. So this was, in fact, one of the underlying tensions that the United States faced really throughout the entire Second World War. Interestingly enough, it's also one of the tensions the United States faced throughout most of the Cold War as well, certainly deep into the 1960s. And that's another fascinating and complex subject. And here again, we see a combination of these mixed results. During the war, African Americans with industrial jobs, the numbers of African Americans who held industrial jobs nearly doubled. At the start of the war, black Americans working in industry made about 40% of what white workers did in 1939. At the end of the war, they made about 60%. So they never achieved parity. They certainly achieved gains, but you couldn't call it parity. African American leaders called for a double V campaign, a double victory campaign. Victory over the Axis, victory against fascism, but also victory for African American rights as well. Membership in the NAACP during the course of the war grew from 10,000 to about 500,000. And the NAACP began to organize a legal team to challenge discriminatory practices, especially practices in American political life, in elections. In 1944, the Supreme Court outlawed the white-only primary election, which was a common practice throughout much of the American South. They led a fight against poll taxes as well, the NAACP did. And there were some slow gains here in terms of American racial justice. The proportion of black Southerners who were registered to vote grew from 3% in 1940 to about 12% by 1947. Again, slow gains, but the beginnings of some shifts. In 1943, moreover, the War Labor Board ordered the end to wage differentials based on race, declaring that whether as vigorous fighting men or for the production of food and munitions, America needs the Negro. That was the statement by the War Labor Board in 1943. So what we see here again is some incremental shifts, slow movement. Much of the progress that was made, moreover, was achieved because African Americans themselves forced the federal government's hand. And probably the most dramatic example of this deals with A. Philip Randolph, who is the gentleman you see in this slide, talking to Eleanor Roosevelt. A. Philip Randolph was the leader of a powerful union called the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters. a very powerful railroad union. And Randolph was convinced that only a show of strength would get black access to good jobs in war industries. And so he announced plans for a march on Washington on March 1st of 1941. And he warned FDR that thousands of African Americans would come to the nation's capital, to the segregated capital of Washington, D.C., unless the federal government took stronger action to fight discrimination in war-related industry. Well, Roosevelt got the message. He was very worried about the political consequences of this. He was worried about what the impact of this might be on the government at the time. He was worried about the impact of this on his own political coalition. And he waited until the last minute, but 1 week before the march was supposed to take place, Roosevelt issued Executive Order 8802, which prohibited racial discrimination in federal employment and in all labor unions and companies that were doing war-related work. That helped raise average wages for black workers, and some 2 million African Americans found employment in war-related industry. It also helped to legitimize a kind of racial progressivism in the employment sectors. The Fair Employment Practices Committee held hearings that were well publicized. They began to investigate firms and corporations that held war contracts that failed to uphold this. That investigative authority now really marked a pivotal turning point. For the first time, really, the federal government, now driven forward by the activism of African Americans, by A. Philip Randolph in particular, was using its authority and its investigative capacity to act on an executive order to ultimately address a long-standing practice of discrimination. What was Roosevelt's thinking on this? Well, twofold. I think Roosevelt recognized that if the United States was going to defeat the Axis, they would need every able-bodied, productive worker possible, and the damage that he would face, the damage that the country would face, if that were not the case, was foreboding, daunting. But he was also under real political strain. Roosevelt had held together this New Deal coalition, including a great deal of Southern Democrats. He was going to risk alienating them by doing this. But to some extent, he felt like this was what had to be done. And of course, his wife Eleanor probably nudged and pushed him in that direction in a significant way, too, which is one of the fascinating stories as well. In Detroit, African-American employees launched a strike against the Chrysler and Ford Motor Corporation plants to protest against discrimination. Discrimination continued despite the executive order, despite the investigative capacity of the Employment Practices Commission. And so African Americans in 1943 actually launched strikes against Chrysler and Ford in Detroit. By that year, a racially integrated crowd of 10,000 people was marching in the streets with banners declaring that Jim Crow must go and bullets and bombs are colorblind. But there were still serious limits in terms of creating this kind of a fully multiracial democracy. There were, in fact, significant counterstrikes launched by white workers as African Americans moved north into defense jobs, as they sought housing, as they sought political power in an America that was still deeply segregated, not only in the South, but across much of the North as well. That racial violence peaked, in fact, in the middle of the war in 1943. There were 250 incidents in 47 cities across the United States. Detroit is probably the most famous and the most horrific case of this. In June of 1943, a fight between young men erupted at the Belle Isle amusement park in Detroit, which ultimately triggered a 30-hour-long riot in which 9 whites and 27 blacks were killed. Nearly 700 people were seriously injured. The enforcement of the order, the enforcement of the executive order, was also almost virtually absent in the South. And this was to some extent the political bargain that Roosevelt was striking. In Baltimore, one African American recalled that even if you had a graduate degree in electronics, you would still get sent to the black entrance for common labor and unskilled work, and there were police to enforce that. Perhaps Roosevelt's greatest failure, and I say this as somebody who's in many respects a real admirer of FDR, somebody who, if you were to ask me to identify what I consider to be my short list of the greatest American presidents, FDR would be up there near the top. But perhaps Roosevelt's greatest failure was his unwillingness to support a federal anti-lynching law. During the New Deal, Roosevelt stated confidentially to one of his aides that the Southerners are the chairman, they occupy strategic places on most of the House and the Senate committees. If I come out for an anti-lynching bill now, they will block every bill I ask Congress to pass to keep America from collapsing. So Roosevelt, again, felt that he was politically constrained in his ability to act, his desire to hold together this New Deal coalition that made him unwilling to push harder. One has to sympathize with that position, I suppose. I still wish Eleanor had his ear a little more strongly. But this was, in fact, the political reality in which he was operating. From my own view as a historian, it is the one thing that I feel was really a great tragedy on FDR's part. Perhaps also most famously, the United States fought the war with a segregated military. And again, I think this speaks to the irony of a war in favor of democracy, a war against fascism, which was fought by a military that was so deeply and rigidly segregated. Since the American Revolution, the act of bearing arms in uniform was associated with the right to claim full citizenship. And public awareness of that, I think, contributed to this struggle over the opportunities that African American soldiers had to serve during the war. More than 1 million African Americans did serve. They made up about 8% of the total US military force. But they did so in a heavily segregated format. Black units were separate, and black officers could not command white men. Black men and officers could not dine with whites, they could not go to the same clubs, they could not enter the post-exchange store, and in some cases they could not pray in the same military-based chapels. High-ranking officers also endorsed this system. The Secretary of War, Henry L. Stimson, justified not appointing black officers on the grounds, as he put it, leadership is not embedded in the Negro race. This was Stimson's position. Blacks were also largely kept out of combat roles as well for a significant part of the war. They worked in road building, they worked in supply carrying, often doing jobs that were quite dangerous, and they were also exposed to hostile fire near front lines. But this did not have the same status and public recognition that combat service did. And this, in fact, was one of the continuing tensions over the course of the war itself. As the war continued, a shortage of combat troops ultimately forced the military to gradually begin putting African Americans in frontline combat positions. And of course, they performed every bit as well as their white peers and colleagues. But this decision was primarily driven by exigency, by the duration of the war. This was not the result of some sort of philosophical turn which emerged at this point among the military's leadership. When progress came, again, it oftentimes did so through black initiative, resulting in a similar pattern, as opposed to government reform. In July of 1944, an accidental explosion of two munition ships took place at a naval base outside of San Francisco. 320 sailors, all of them ammunition loaders, were killed instantly. And loading munition ships, as you can imagine, was an extremely dangerous business. They're carrying live ordnance. Oftentimes, if they were supplying battleships, they would actually be carrying bags of gunpowder itself, double-lined sealed bags of gunpowder. The slightest spark, the slightest piece of friction could result in a massive explosion. And that's what happened there in the summer of 1944. These two ships simply detonated. 320 sailors, all of them ammunition loaders, were killed instantly. 200 of those 320 were African American. After repairs were made to the base, after other ships were brought in, the African American sailors who survived the incident were ordered to go back to work. They refused to do so until their safety was assured. They said, look, we don't feel confident that these issues have been addressed. We're not going to do this until you can demonstrate to us that our welfare is protected. 50 of them were jailed, court-martialed for mutiny, and sentenced to terms of up to 8 to 15 years. At that point, interestingly enough, the NAACP became involved. And a young special counsel named Thurgood Marshall wrote a letter to the Secretary of the Navy, James Forrestal. And Marshall asked some key questions. Why were only blacks being returned to the loading job at the base? They organized protest meetings, they launched petitions, they filed newspaper stories. And I think what began to build here was an appeal to the law, as well as the kind of political organizing which would ultimately drive forward significant civil rights progress in the future. In 1945, the Navy, remarkably, announced the end of segregation in its training camps, and many other programs as well. The black sailors who had been convicted in this case were all released. It was an early sign, then, of what it would take to make significant and lasting changes, both a legal assault as well as the creation of a movement culture. And one of the great lessons, I think, that began to emerge out of the war as the civil rights movement would begin to take hold is that neither could really succeed without the other. It would be that combination of a legal assault as well as the creation of a movement culture would achieve much greater progress in the future. So at this point, why don't we take a short break? I know Joanne is indicating to me it's time for us to take a short break. We'll take about 10 minutes, and then we'll reconvene, and I'll go ahead and continue by talking a little bit more about a subject that I think has great relevance not only for the war, but also for our own time as well. So with that, we'll go ahead and take a pause then. Thank you.
Thank you for taking your seats again. And now we're back.
So I'm going to go ahead and speak for probably another 15 minutes or so. And then we should have plenty of time for questions to follow. So again, I'll look forward to your questions. Probably the most striking case of the limits of American wartime democracy, I think, really was in the internment of Japanese Americans. American propaganda, U.S. government, wartime propaganda, described the Axis enemies as driven by a vicious political system. And many Americans were willing to accept the idea that it was fascism, not the German or the Italian people, who were the real enemies. I think throughout the war, in fact, there were still fairly benign views of Germans and Italians at home. The Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, however, and the sheer brutality of the war in the Pacific, combined with a long-standing anti-Asian prejudice across much of the Western U.S., produced a different reaction toward America's Japanese-American population. The conviction here was that Japanese Americans themselves were a security risk merely because of their national origin. And so I think there's actually a very complicated thing which began to unfold at this point. Americans were able to accept or to rationalize that the Germans or Italians were the victims of a vicious political system. The German and Italian people had been betrayed, subverted, abused, and oppressed by the Nazi government. By fascist Italy. And yet, Americans had a much tougher time thinking about the Japanese population in the same way. And again, some of that had to do with the long history of anti-Asian prejudice in the United States, especially in the American West. Some of it had to do with the attack at Pearl Harbor and the deep sense of American anger and sense of resentment there. And then I think also some of it really did have to do with the sheer nature of the war in the Pacific. The news, for example, coming out of the Philippines, the atrocities that Japan carried out in China, the extent to which the war in the Pacific had truly become, in many cases, a war without mercy on any side, I think deepened this sense. In any case, the conviction was that Japanese Americans were a security risk because of their national origin. U.S. General John L. DeWitt, who was the chief of the West Coast Defense Command, put it this way. Japanese race is an enemy race. It makes no difference whether he is an American citizen or not. And that statement, that official statement of policy, was one that was ultimately put into place. FDR signed Executive Order 9066, which allowed military leaders to define the areas from which any person could be excluded as a protection against espionage or sabotage. In March of 1942, the U.S. government began to relocate all Japanese Americans on the West Coast, moving them out of the West Coast, and transporting them to internment camps in the interior of the United States. Nativists and racists who had resented Japanese American success as farmers, as merchants, as fishermen, eagerly supported that because they watched their economic competition depart. And yet I think across much of the American public opinion, this was something that was viewed as acceptable and perhaps even necessary. By the fall of 1942, over 100,000 Japanese Americans lost their jobs. They lost their homes, they lost their businesses, they were forced to live in scattered and desolate camps, camps with minimal furnishings and minimal privacy, surrounded by barbed wire, searchlights, and constant surveillance. They lived in the tar paper shacks and barracks of places like Manzanar, in the Central Valley of California, surrounded by spotlights and armed guards. The eventual total of Japanese Americans who were interned during the course of the war ran to 120,000. 70,000 of that 120,000 were United States citizens, born in the United States. Interestingly enough, the process of internment provoked deep discussion and division among Japanese Americans. There were some who were bitterly alienated by what had been done to them and their families, who resolved to wait out the war, to go ahead and try to survive it, and put their lives back together as best they could, alienated from the government which had done this to them. Others, interestingly enough, decided that they were determined to prove their loyalty to the United States, and nearly 4,000 of them fought, mostly in the segregated 442nd Regimental Combat Team, joining the United States Army. So you can imagine how it's hard almost to wrap my head around this. A family is evicted from their homes. Families are evicted from their homes, they lose their jobs, they lose their livelihood, they lose their property, their businesses. They are, in many cases, U.S. citizens. They are sent into the interior of the United States, crowded into tar paper barracks, surrounded by spotlights and armed guards, and a significant number of them, close to 4,000, say, well, our reaction is going to be that we're going to prove we're Americans, we're going to enlist in the United States Army, and we're going to fight. It's really kind of amazing. But nearly 4,000 Japanese Americans did just that. They joined the United States Army, they fought in the 442nd Regimental Combat Team, and they were, in fact, the most highly decorated unit in the U.S. Army. And there's a rich irony which began to build here. One of the most striking ironies of the war is that while their own families were imprisoned, Japanese Americans helped to liberate concentration camps held by the Nazis. It's really, really quite striking. As you might imagine, there was also a significant political and legal move which began to build. Japanese Americans, but also many progressive white Americans and others who were so horrified by what had happened, began a series of legal challenges to the process of internment, arguing that this violated their citizenship rights, it violated the 14th Amendment, it violated their privacy rights. In 1944, however, the Supreme Court validated the legality of the action. They affirmed the legality of the action. And this, the most famous of these cases, there were several, but the most famous of these cases was known as the Korematsu case. Fred Korematsu was born in the United States, in California. He was a United States citizen living in the town of San Leandro in Northern California. And he refused the internment order. He said, look, I'm a U.S. citizen. The government has no right to do this to me. He had tried to join the Coast Guard during World War II. He tried to enlist in the Coast Guard, but the service would not allow him to complete an application. He was then convicted for resisting the internment order to vacate his home and to move to a relocation center. He filed an appeal, and ultimately his challenge, he challenged the conviction, and ultimately the case worked its way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. The court majority admitted, they acknowledged, that any curtailment of civil rights of a group defined by race should be immediately suspect. Those were the words of the majority opinion. They should be immediately suspect. But the court also determined that the war powers of the United States Congress and the executive justified the exclusion orders due to military danger. They also held that a blanket order, despite the lack of any attempt to evaluate evidence of disloyalty on the part of those under it, was also legal. So this was, in fact, a stunning decision. It was a 6-3 decision, so it was not unanimous. And the dissenters on the court issued blistering dissents. One of them, Justice Frank Murphy, argued that the decision went over the brink of constitutional power and into what he called the ugly abyss of racism. Scholars and journalists also immediately dissented, but the camps remained. They remained for the duration of the war. To this day, in fact, if you drive through Central California, you can visit the site where the Manzanar camp was, and you can see this tremendously barren desert landscape flanked by high mountains, freezing during the winter, brutally hot during the summer, a treeless, barren desert environment. And those camps operated throughout the duration of the war itself. Silence surrounded the entire experience after the war. Silence on the part of many Japanese Americans who had been humiliated and in many cases had seen their families so adversely affected by the experience. School textbooks didn't mention this, nor did war memorials mention it. There had been a direct violation of constitutional protections and legal guarantees of equality, guarantees of freedom of movement, guarantees for the protection of private property, and presumptions of innocence for those not until they were proven guilty. Interestingly enough, in fact, over the entire course of the war, there were no documented cases of sabotage by Japanese Americans. There simply was no evidence that this was a serious threat. What began to build as well, I think, was a deep sense of shame and anguish among those who had been interned, and they themselves really spoke very little about it. Evidence only slowly began to come to light, and public discussion only slowly began to build in the wake of the civil rights movement of the 1960s. During the 1970s, Karen Korematsu was a high school student in San Leandro, California, sitting in history class one day when she heard about a man who went to court to challenge the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II. She was shocked to suddenly realize that this man was her own father, that he had never said a word about it, never told her about it. She had no idea. So you can imagine what happens as she begins to hear about the Korematsu case. There's this man named Fred Korematsu who brought this case and it got to the U.S. Supreme Court. And she's sitting there thinking, gee, my dad is Fred Korematsu. It's a rather sort of striking, rather striking moment. In 1983, Fred Korematsu joined a party of lawyers, including many young Japanese Americans, to go to the U.S. District Court in Northern California, and they brought a case to vacate the convictions. And they did so on the basis that they had actually, through historical research in the archives, they had found evidence that the FBI and the Justice Department had issued opinions and had written reports indicating that there had been no acts of sabotage up to 1944, that they did not believe there was any risk of espionage, And that certainly after the Battle of Midway in 1942, the possibility of a Japanese invasion of the West Coast was simply beyond unlikely, minimal. And yet, when the government made its case in 1944, that evidence was suppressed. That evidence was not included. In fact, historians found documents indicating that there were Justice Department officials who said, the original report made reference to dissenting opinions, and then the final report actually removed those references. And there were protests, written protests of those changes in the US government documents, which the historians found. And so ultimately, Korematsu and his colleagues in 1983 brought this case forward to the Northern District in California and said, you know, this was a complete misjustice, a complete injustice, and moreover, there was suppression of evidence on the part of the government in the case itself. The U.S. government reaction, the U.S. attorneys, went to Korematsu and they said, well, how about this? How about if the federal government and the president, President Reagan, issues you a pardon? We'll pardon you. And Korematsu said, you know, I'm the one who should be pardoning you. You can keep your pardon. We're going to court. And they did. Ultimately, the judge agreed in the case, agreed with Korematsu's perspective. His conviction was wiped clean, and the judge issued an order warning that the case stood as a constant caution, these are the judge's words, as a constant caution that in times of war or declared military necessity, our institutions must be vigilant in protecting constitutional guarantees, that the government has an obligation, again, these are the words, to protect all citizens from the petty fears and prejudices that are so easily aroused. The Japanese American Citizens League had also requested in 1978 that Congress issue a formal apology and also, more politically controversially, restitution. A multiracial commission conducted public hearings, interviewed 750 witnesses, and finally recommended modest reparations of $20,000 to each person who had been interned. Congress acted on that in 1988. Korematsu himself was then awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom by President Clinton in 1998. So, if we think about these longer-term outcomes, and on the left, that's Fred Korematsu holding his White House letter, indicating he's just been awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom. And that's a very young Thurgood Marshall on the other side of the slide. If we think about these stories, and we think about this broader picture, I think we see something really quite interesting. The home front was crucial to American success in the global war against fascism. The mobilization of the economy, the ability to reconvert American industry, the ability to harness America's power, ultimately both economically and politically, was a staggering accomplishment. And to do so in such a short period of time was really, really amazing. The very worst fears of those forecasting damage to American democracy were not realized. The Republic survived, ultimately came through the war, and yet what we clearly see is not a democratic golden age either. Ultimately, in some respects, World War II would become a turning point, and there would be significant gains and advances that would follow it. The war triggered changes in women's consciousness, even if new rights were not granted. The experience of working on behalf of the war effort, spending time on the factory floor, doing those kinds of projects, mobilizing politically, had a lasting and powerful impact. The war also triggered changes for African Americans. For many black veterans and activists, it became a crucial moment. As one black enlistee put it after spending 4 years in the US Army, I'm damned if I'm going to let the Alabama version of the Germans push me around. What I think really began here was a fusion, a powerful fusion, of legal activism alongside collective action that would ultimately drive the beginnings of the civil rights movement forward. A combination of law and will, if you will. And I think that ultimately, in many respects, it's really here, it's out of this process, that you see the beginning of a much more powerful and much more transformative civil rights movement, which ultimately calls upon the United States to live up to the real promises of its democratic beginnings. And I think there are lessons for our own time here as well. Claims to national security, demands for extraordinary measures, are in our own newspapers again. They're in our radio broadcasts. They're in our public debate and discussion. The nature of the threat is different. The nature of the conflict is certainly quite different. And yet, I would argue that some of the same problems are still at issue for a country like the United States, for a country that pledges to uphold these values as a liberal democracy. Once more, I think, we face the risk of enacting policies in the name of national security that may, in fact, do grave damage to the very values and democratic fabric that we propose to uphold and to defend. And I think this is, in many cases, one of the fundamental dilemmas that the United States faces in any time it confronts and addresses these questions of warfare. So at that point, I'm going to stop and thank you all for your terrific attendance and really I'm just delighted to see you. You've got a great audience. So I'm happy to answer questions. I think we've got about maybe 20, 25 minutes. Why don't we begin? So, yes, sir.
Mine's before Sherman. You mentioned how the Japanese were treated different than the Germans and the Italians. And I'm wondering if the fact that you didn't, or at least I didn't hear you mention it, was our ignorance of the Japanese society. We didn't know the militaries in Japan as compared to the moderates or whatever else. And I'm thinking that ignorance in the population, plus our prejudices, we all know we have, contributed to the situation. Bringing that forward to today, don't we have the same kind of a situation in that our news media is not, we're very ignorant of what's going on around the world, and that makes it hard for us to really be a democracy.
So the question, I'm going to repeat the question so everybody can hear it. The question had to do with the difference, in fact, in the way that Americans thought about the Japanese as opposed to the way they thought about Italians or Germans, to some extent may have been driven by our ignorance of Japanese culture and society, our ignorance of what was happening of the war leaders in Japan, and the possibility that in our own current climate, we see a similar kind of ignorance unfolding, a lack of understanding, and perhaps in that context, or that lack of understanding is where we see these kinds of more deliberately racial sort of convictions begin to take hold. I think you're onto something very important there. And I think that's one of the factors that certainly was at work.
And if I may follow on just quickly, the foreign policy that we followed after the Second World War strikes me as not being very friendly to democracies in other parts of the world.
That's true. Yes, and again, the follow-up question had to talk about what happens following the war itself and America's own commitment to democracy abroad. This is, I would argue again, one of the great dilemmas of the Cold War period too, which is actually the period that I have dedicated most of my own research to. One of the things that you see, as much as the United States launches things like the Marshall Plan, as much as the United States does what it can do to in fact help bring about the end of imperialism, the end of the British Empire, for example, as the United States rebuilds and ultimately helps generate a thriving European economy, builds up a great degree of stability. Certainly in many cases the U.S. could hardly be pointed to as a promoter of democracy. And one can think of many cases, whether it be places like the Philippines, support for Ferdinand Marcos, the dictatorship there, what happens in Indonesia, what happens in parts of Central America, Iran, for that matter, one can point to many cases where it's hard to make that that sort of claim. Yes, in the back.
How were Japanese Americans treated in Hawaii and other territories in the Pacific?
Great question. So the question about internment then, about Japanese Americans. Well, what happened in Hawaii? What happened in other parts of the Pacific? Interestingly enough, in Hawaii, Japanese Americans were not interned in massive numbers. And part of the reason for that was, in some respects, a logistical and practical one. The Japanese American population in Hawaii was enormous. And really, almost the majority of the population, if you were to try to intern them, you can imagine trying to load them on ships and send them to the mainland United States or something. The U.S., the economy on Oahu, where I grew up, would have collapsed. And so there actually was no mass internment of Japanese Americans in Hawaii. Now, certain Japanese Americans who, because of their ancestry, because of their ties to people on the home islands, were detained. Some of them detained throughout the entire course of the war, but you didn't see mass internment. And to some extent, it was really just a matter of, I think, just the sheer logistics that were involved. But it is one of the ironies, right? If you wanted to point to a place where you thought espionage or sabotage might be, you know, you might really worry about it if you were a U.S. military commander, it wasn't done there. One of the other ironies as well, in fact, was that, this is one of the things that you learn growing up, as I did as a Navy kid at Pearl Harbor, there was such anxiety on the part of U.S. military officials in the months leading up to Pearl Harbor. They knew that a strike was going to come somewhere. They didn't know where, they didn't know when. But there was such anxiety about the possibility of a strike that the United States began to take a number of measures to try to prevent sabotage militarily. And so at places like Hickam Air Force Base on Oahu, what that meant was that they began to take aircraft which had been largely dispersed across larger areas of space and clustered them in groups so that they could be easily defended. Now, you can imagine what happens when the Japanese Zeros come flying across the tarmac and they look down and they say, well, that's convenient. it certainly made their jobs a lot easier. And this is, again, one of the tragedies here. The degree to which the United States was so worried about the loyalty of this population actually even had these adverse military consequences as well. Yes, in purple.
Was there a decision of any sort to not accept or allow Jews, refugees fleeing Europe? I mean, it seems like we've heard that Roosevelt and those directly under him were opposed to letting.
Right. So the question had to do with U.S. policy regarding Jewish refugees and others who were fleeing fascism. Very, very few Jews were admitted into the United States. And in fact, the United States did nothing to change its immigration quotas. They did nothing to address this. One of the saddest stories that you actually see is the fact that the U.S. does not reverse policy there. There are actually cases of ships loaded with refugees traveling to the Caribbean, trying to gain entry to U.S. ports, being turned away and being sent back to Europe. This is another one of the darkest chapters of the Second World War. Interestingly enough, there were actually Jewish leaders who, as the Holocaust begins to unfold and knowledge of the Holocaust becomes deeper, there were actually Jewish leaders who went to the U.S. government, to the War Department, eventually, and asked the U.S. to bomb the concentration camps, to destroy the engines, to destroy the rail lines, to destroy the gas chambers, to destroy the mechanism that allowed the industrial killing that the Nazis were carrying out to continue. U.S. government did not do that. They did strike railroad targets, they did strike industrial targets, but there was never a shift in military policy to focus on this issue. Instead, their consistent approach was, we want to end the war as fast as possible. We understand this is happening, but we want to end the war as fast as possible. That too is a subject of continuing debate and discussion among historians. But it is one of the saddest and darkest chapters of the war. Yes, sir, at the back.
We had a Japanese-American friend in Newton who was drafted towards the end of the war and then used in Japan as an interpreter because he could speak the Japanese language. When he came back as a civilian, he went to a local church and the assistant pastor told him he was not welcome there.
It's a sad story. It's recounting an experience of a family friend who was Japanese American who served in the course of the war. was not welcome to a local church. Yeah, that's, again, it's one of the, I think it's one of the darker chapters. You know, it's interesting. Looking back, you look at these events, and we've certainly made a great deal of progress in many respects since those times. And yet, I think this process, this unfolding of the full realization of America's democratic process, I would argue is one that requires that kind of constant commitment and dedication to change. Yes, Eric.
That second slide you showed, and you presented the argument as to why that the big businesses survived, the efficiency of their systems, and the federal contracts went to them, and the conservative concerns, which obviously were legitimate because of the way it turned out after the war, but what did the conservative argument offer? Did they have a counter suggestion as to a way to do this?
Not really. You know, the question had to do with the conservative argument, conservative criticism of the concentration of firms, the growth, and really the alteration of the economy in the course of the war. What did the conservatives have to offer? You know, it was hard to make an effective argument. I think a lot of what they were arguing was that the New Deal itself was an encroachment. That now we saw this deep, even deeper reach, and that the fear was that this would now continue into the post-war period, that in fact this would ultimately be the point from which there would be no return. And so that what they were lamenting, for example, the damage done to small businesses, this sort of what they saw as the lack of the ability of individual private entrepreneurs to succeed, this was ultimately, I think, their fear was that this was sort of the turning point from which there would be no return. Interestingly enough, you know, even you actually have Eisenhower in his own farewell address lamenting the rise of the military-industrial complex. And this, of course, from the Supreme Allied Commander in Europe. And to some extent, there was this continuing deep relationship between defense industry, the federal government, and this became, in some respects, a permanent part of the legacy which generates after the war itself. But I think the real conservative fear was that this was the point of no return. You know, that we would never be able to see this what they saw as this encroachment be beaten back. Yes, George.
This is more a statement, but I'm interested in your reaction to it. I'll state, I was in second grade at the beginning of the war, seventh grade at the end. I'm going to speak about the generation of the 1950s in colleges, which I was one of. I think we were are still an enormously conservative generation. And I believe it's another sort of anti-democratic aspect of World War II. We were taught to be adjusted, not maladjusted, which means don't complain. This is the way things are. You're never going to change it. So just settle down, keep your nose to the grindstone, and soldier on. And soldier in a literal, almost literal sense, because we pretended we were soldiers.
Yeah. I mean, George is sort of describing the experience of having sort of gone through the war during his own childhood, and sort of what that meant following, and the kind of sort of conservatism, I think, it was sort of built into the way one thought about daily life. It's interesting. I think you also see this in the lives of people who experienced the Great Depression and the way that they think about sort of their daily patterns. I can recall, you know, my mother's parents, one thing you never, ever, ever did was waste food. You just did not do that. And I think, you know, it was such a firm ethic that was so deeply ingrained. Some of the most interesting conversations that I had were with my own grandfather, who had been a submarine commander in the Pacific during the course of the war, you know, would very rarely talk about any of this until finally, I think I was in sixth grade and I was doing a project for elementary school, and we were supposed to interview a grandparent, and I sat down to interview them. Budding young historian, you know, I'm going to interview my grandfather. And we had a conversation about his experience in the war, and you know, he talked about the searing terror that he experienced in a U.S. submarine that had just recently been equipped with FM sonar, one of the first that were equipped with sonar. And of course, once the FM sonar was developed, it became clear what the purpose of it was to be able to navigate a minefield. That you would use the sonar to try to identify mines as you brought a submarine through the Sea of Japan and attacked Japanese shipping. A number of the crew on the submarine to which he was assigned as a young man immediately transferred out. Because once they realized, you know, that he was a fairly young person, once they realized what this mission was going to be, they wanted no part of this. It was, I think, you know, and he describes the effect of, you know, as you're navigating a minefield, there's no computer. So you're doing this, you know, doing trigonometry basically in your head. You know, the sonarman's saying, you know, there's a contact at 20 degrees, 200 yards, another contact, 40 degrees, 500 yards. He's plotting this, and you're looking at the map, and you're driving and trying to avoid these. What it's like to scrape a mine cable, as you hear the cable run along the hull of the ship, the fear that if you go into it, it'll pull the mine down. And you know, it's interesting, sort of having gone through this experience, and the trauma that this was involved. I can recall asking him as a kid, "What do you feel about the Japanese people today?" And you know, he lived the rest of his life in Hawaii. He married a woman from Hawaii and spent the rest of his life there. And interestingly enough, by that point, and this was probably late 70s, I think he finally was able to say that they were the victims as well of the war. And they were the victims as well of a militarized fascist government, and that they suffered terribly. But I think that that was a sense of perspective that he only developed over a very long period of time, and only much later in his life. Luther.
Yeah, my question, I think, goes in the same general direction as George's. One of my most vivid childhood memories was the bombing of Pearl Harbor. I was, I think, about 5 or 5 and a half years old. And I remember that very vividly. And then a lot of the war itself is kind of vague. I do remember VJ Day because of the festivities and the bonfires, and that was very exciting. But one of the things I began to think about later was the conclusion of that war, the dropping of the atom bombs.
Right.
And I don't really have any good sense of, was that a matter of controversy in the United States? Was part of the acceptance of that this bias against the Japanese? That's the question.
Yeah. So Luther's question has to do with the end of the war and the U.S. decision to use the atomic bombs in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and whether there was a substantial amount of controversy, public controversy, in the U.S. about that at the time. Interestingly enough, there was not a whole lot of controversy at the time. There certainly were some people who talked about the sense of foreboding once the scale of the damage became apparent. There certainly were people who politically argued against the decision. A group of, in fact, American atomic scientists, a number of them warned against the use of the weapon this way because they felt it would start a flying arms race with the Soviet Union. They were correct. In that regard. There were others who dissented against it once the full scale of destruction began to appear. And you see some of that in works like John Hersey's book, Hiroshima, which talks about the scale of the destruction, the lives lost. But there was not a lot of public dissent. In fact, Truman presented this more directly as the solving of a tremendous scientific problem, and an action that brought the war to a swift close with the saving of large numbers of American lives. Interestingly enough, some of the critics of the decision actually did come from within the U.S. military. One of the critics, for example, was Chester Nimitz, the leader of the United States Navy. And Nimitz's position was, you know what, we had them beaten. It was a matter of time. We were going to beat them. We could starve them out. Ultimately, they would defeat. But there was a lot of controversy and a lot of internal debate. But as far as operational policy goes, we see very little evidence that Truman ever hesitated. In fact, as soon as Truman goes to Potsdam in 1945, it's a famous meeting with Joseph Stalin. And Truman says to Stalin, he says, you know, we have this weapon. He doesn't tell him it's an atomic bomb, but he says we have a weapon of incredible destructive power. you should be aware that we've developed this weapon. And there's a sense to which, you know, he's hoping that Stalin will sort of be somewhat intimidated by this and back off. And Stalin's response is, oh, well, I hope you use it against the Japanese. Because, of course, the Russians already knew all about the bomb. They had penetrated the Manhattan Project with espionage. They knew a great deal about it. Stalin probably knew more than Truman did. But there was very little sort of internal debate. We like to imagine that there must have been some debate among Truman and his lead advisors about the use of the weapon, and there really wasn't. So that too is another fascinating subject, itself probably worth another book, of course. I should probably stop here, maybe I'll take one more question and then we'll draw things to a close.
Yes, more of a statement than a question. I was in my junior year at Oregon State College at the time with any number of Japanese companions, that not only in the classroom, but they were in the ROTC program,
sure,
which was required at a land-grant college. It was hard to think of them as an enemy at that time.
Yeah. And I think that's quite telling. I think you're observing this experience of being at Oregon State with Japanese-American students as colleagues. And I think ultimately in those settings, it does become hard to imagine them as enemies. Thank you so much. You've been a terrific audience. Thanks a lot.
Mike, I think the number of hands that were still up indicates the interest you've generated in really an extraordinary lecture. I think we would all agree. And we on the planning committee have a slight gift for you. And since I have something to do with that, with the gift, I get to present it to you. It's a publication of 2009 that was probably the first major activity of the Community Education Council. We decided we wanted to commemorate our World War II veterans while they were still with us. And we put together 29 stories from World War II veterans connected with Powhatan County. The important thing is that any one of Iowa's 99 counties and every county in the United States could have produced an equally interesting volume of stories. That's how involved our society was in World War II. There are 29 stories here, 6 from Grinnell College professors. Art Hyman is in there, Emily Fitch's husband. John is in, and by the way, related to the bomb, John, who had fought in Europe, was ready. They were going to get a little bit of leave and then remobilized and go to Japan. So those folks thought the atomic bomb was a terrific introduction into the war environment. So this is our gift to you for a really extraordinary morning. Thank you. Thank you very much.